In this video, we're going to use one concept, surface area to volume ratio, to explain why cells are small, why whales are big, why elephants have big ears, why flatworms have no special system for moving oxygen into their cells, and why when you get cold, you hold your arms against your body. One concept to explain them all. Let's start with a demonstration. This block is made of agar, a seaweed extract, a bit of the base sodium hydroxide, and a pH indicator. This pH indicator, phenolphthalein, is this very nice fuchsia color when it's exposed to a base, and it turns clear when the pH turns acidic. I've cut cubes of this agar into four different sizes. The biggest is 3 centimeters on a side. The others are 2, 1, and 0.5 centimeters on a side. I'm going to put these cubes into a dish of vinegar, a weak acid. Watch what happens. In 6 minutes, the tiny cube has lost its fuchsia color and turned completely white. The other cubes still have some fuchsia inside, and the percentage that's still fuchsia goes up with the size of each cube. In other words, vinegar diffused into 100% of the smallest cube's volume, while it reached only 19% of the largest cube's volume. Let's get our heads around what's really going on. Diffusion is the movement of molecules in a fluid, a gas or a liquid, from where they're more concentrated or bunched up to where they're more spread out. It's how this drop of food coloring is spreading throughout this flask. You don't have to stir or add energy. The random movement of the food coloring molecules will lead them over time to move apart from one another. When we put our agar cubes in the vinegar is more concentrated outside the cubes than it is inside. So because there's nothing from stopping the vinegar from moving in, the vinegar diffuses from where it is outside the cubes to where it isn't inside the cubes. The vinegar is diffusing through the outer surface of each cube, and we can quantify the amount of surface by measuring the surface area of each cube. In this table, I'm going to list the surface area for each of the 4 cubes, plus 3 imaginary ones. One smaller, 0.1 centimeters on a side, and 2 bigger, 5 centimeters on a side, and 10 centimeters on a side. The vinegar is diffusing through the outer surface and into the cube's volume. The smallest cube has the smallest volume at 0.001 centimeters cubed, while the largest cube has the largest volume, 1,000 centimeters cubed. What we're concerned with is the ratio of surface area to volume. A ratio is the relationship between two numbers, and the ratio we want is the ratio between the surface area for each cube divided by its volume. So in our tiny imaginary cube, 0.1 centimeters on a side, the surface area to volume ratio is 60 to 1. In the largest cube that we're considering, 10 centimeters on a side, the ratio is 100 times less, 0.6 to 1. The smaller a cube is, the larger its ratio of surface area to volume. And conversely, the larger a cube is, the smaller its ratio of surface area to volume. In other words, the larger something is, the less surface area it has relative to its volume. And that's why cells are small. Cells, to stay alive, have to exchange materials with their environment. For most cells, that means that things like oxygen and food need to go in, and carbon dioxide and other waste need to come out. That exchange is largely by diffusion. If cells were too big, then diffusion wouldn't work in terms of reaching the entire volume of the cell. Just pretend that the smallest agar cube was a cell, and that the vinegar molecules were oxygen. This cell is doing fine. Oxygen is getting all the way deep into the cell. Things are diffusing in and out. This cell is well adapted to exchange substances with its environment through diffusion. But if these larger cubes were also cells, they'd be having a hard time. Whatever needs to get in isn't getting in very far. A lot of this poor cell would be suffocating and filling up with waste that can't diffuse out. Tininess gives cells a very high surface area to volume ratio, and that's why cells are small. All right, so what's with the flat ears on the elephants? Well, elephants are mammals just like we are, and like us, they maintain a constantly high body temperature. We mammals like our cells to be warm, but too warm is dangerous because excessive heat can reduce enzyme function by denaturing enzymes. That can kill you. Because elephants are big, their bodies have very little surface area relative to their enormous volume. And this makes it very difficult for heat to diffuse out the elephant's body. So think about this in terms of the long, slow process of evolution. As the ancestors of elephants evolved to grow bigger, they needed other adaptations to improve their ability to allow heat to diffuse out of their bodies. And that's what the elephant's huge ears do. In the thin flap of skin that makes up each ear, blood can circulate, and the heat in that blood, being close to the surface, can diffuse out of the elephant's body. That's the adaptation, a flat sheet of tissue that makes heat diffusion easier. To simulate this, let's cut a flat sheet of our phenolphthalein agar and put that in vinegar. Because it's flat, this flat sheet has a very high surface area to volume ratio. So it's very easy for the vinegar to reach the entire volume of this sheet in a relatively short time. Summary: big flat appendages with their high surface area to volume ratio are often adaptations for radiating heat into the environment. And how about this flatworm? No heart, no lungs. How is oxygen getting to all of its cells? How is carbon dioxide getting out? Because these animals are flat, they have a very high surface area to volume ratio. So you can assume that oxygen just diffuses from the surrounding water in and carbon dioxide from the body cells out. And what about the huge size of whales? For whales, who often live in cold water, the problem is the opposite of the problem that elephants face. Elephants have to deal with overheating. Whales have to struggle with hypothermia, with heat loss. So think about the fact that in water that's a nice 80 degrees, a human being can become hypothermic within a couple of hours. How do whales survive lifelong immersion in ocean water? Size is a big part of how whales adapted to the cold stress involved in living in water. Whales are huge. Huge things, just by the math, have a very low surface area to volume ratio. That means that the heat inside a whale's body is effectively trapped inside. There's no way for it to get out. Remember our cubes. Large size is bad for diffusion. So just by evolving large size, whales decreased their surface area to volume ratio. This made it easier for them to maintain their body temperature. It was a selective advantage. Genes for size got passed on because of surface area to volume considerations. You know, I'm filming this in early winter, and it just got pretty cold here in California. Oh my goodness, look at what I did. I'm holding my arms against my body. By doing that, I'm effectively decreasing my surface area while, of course, keeping my volume the same. Holy cow, that means that this is a behavioral adaptation for decreasing my surface area to volume ratio, preventing diffusion of heat. And what about this? These ridges of tissue are the villi of the small intestine. Their job? Absorbing food from the gut into the bloodstream. Why do you think they have this wavy shape? Because a wavy surface increases surface area to volume ratios. To demonstrate this, I cut a piece of agar to very roughly the shape of the villi of the small intestine. All of these ridges have the effect of increasing the surface area to volume ratio. As a result, diffusion happens more easily, and you can absorb the food that you need to absorb from your gut into your blood. We've seen in this video how important surface area to volume ratios are, how increasing the ratio of surface area to volume makes diffusion easier, leading to adaptations like big ears in elephants or the flat shape of flatworms and wavy tissues. We've also seen how decreasing the ratio of surface area to volume makes diffusion harder, leading to adaptations like folded arms against our body or evolving to great size if you're a whale. So thanks so much for joining me. Over at sciencemusicvideos.com, you'll be able to find an interactive tutorial about surface area and volume. It's going to really help you solidify your understanding of this unbelievably powerful concept. So head on over to sciencemusicvideos.com where you can study this or dozens of other topics. I want to thank you for joining me. Again, leave me comments, leave me questions, and I'll see you next time at our next video.